Dear students, welcome to this session. In this session, we are going to look into the different types of generators. In the previous session, we looked into what is a DC machine, and a DC machine is basically a machine which converts electrical energy, DC electrical energy into mechanical energy, or mechanical energy into DC electrical energy. That is called as a DC machine. We have two machines in a DC machine. One is called as a generator, DC generator, and another one is a DC motor. What is a DC generator? DC generator is the electrical machine which converts the mechanical energy into DC electrical energy. That is called as a DC generator. And we also looked into the principle of operation. DC generator works on the Faraday's first law of electromagnetic induction, that is, whenever flux linked with a coil or a conductor changes, an EMF is induced in that particular coil or conductor. Then we looked into how the DC generator operates, and also the action of the commutator segment. So what is a commutator segment? Commutator segment, we can think it as a mechanical rectifier which converts the negative cycle into positive cycle. So that is how we get all the electrical energy that is generated as a direct current form. There are different types of generator based on how the excitation of the generator is done. What is the excitation of the generator? For DC generator, we use the field winding. We will see the construction where you will understand. We use the field winding, and that field winding is used to create a magnetic field. And how that field winding is connected with the armature winding, we have different types of generator. DC generators, broadly they are classified into separately excited DC generator and self-excited DC generator. In case of a separately excited DC generator, the field winding is excited, means it is supplied with the external DC supply. Okay, so that is the separately excited DC generator. Since the generator is generating the direct current electricity, the same DC can be used for its own field as well. If we use the whatever the DC generator generates the voltage, if that particular voltage is used to excite or give as a supply to the field winding, then we call it as a self-excited generator. In case of a separately excited generator, the field winding is excited or given supply from a external DC source. In case of a self-excited DC generator, the field winding is given a supply from the same DC generator, because the DC generator is going to generate the DC supply. That supply itself is used. That is why we call it as a self-excited DC generator. The self-excited DC generator are classified into three different motors. One is a series motor and series generator. The self-excited DC generators are classified into three categories: series generator, shunt generator, and compound generator. What is a series generator? In case of a series generator, field winding is connected in series with the armature winding. And what is a shunt generator? The field winding is connected in parallel to the armature winding. And the third one is, it's a combination. So in this case, field is connected in series, that is series generator. The field winding is connected in parallel, that is a shunt generator. Combination of these two is called as a compound generator. In case of a compound generator, we have long shunt generator and short shunt generator. The long shunt generator, we will have combination. The field winding is, in this case, the field winding is divided into two parts. One part will be in parallel to the armature winding. Okay, if the one part of the field winding is in parallel to the armature winding and both of them are in series with the another part of the field winding, then it is called as a short shunt generator. In case of a long shunt, armature winding would be in parallel with a part of the field winding, and both this series combination is in parallel with another part of the field winding, that is called as a long shunt. So when we talk about the construction, and later you will come to know what is these are the what are the is how these are different. Okay, next we will see the construction of a DC generator, because before you see in the diagram, you can see the main parts of a DC generator. The main parts of a DC generator is the outer frame. So you can see the outer frame, and this is the outer frame forms as a support structure. It is a mechanical support structure that is made with a cast iron or a material like that, which gives the support, external support. And we have this is the pole system. Okay, we have the main pole system, or you can also say it is a field winding system. In the main pole, we have the pole structure here. It has a pole core and a pole shoe, and on the pole core we have the field winding, and then we have the this is a stationary part. This particular pole is bolted onto the frame, so this structure will be fixed onto the frame, and on top of this we will have the field winding. Why we need the field winding? So that we can create the magnetic field. And inside, this air gap won't be this bigger. Okay, just in the diagram it is shown like this. The air gap is very small, about 4 mm or 6 mm, very small air gap would be there. And this is the armature part, this is the rotating part, and this armature will be having a slots on the outer periphery. And this armature is it's a cylindrical structure and made up with a cast made up with a silicon steel material, and using a thin lamination. All those thin laminations are stacked together to form the cylindrical structure. So this is a imagine it is a cylindrical structure, and on the outer periphery we have the slots, and inside the slots we place the winding, that is a armature winding. And this whole armature is mounted on a shaft. So this is a shaft, and also on the shaft we will have a commutator segment mounted. So you can see this is a commutator segment, and on top of the commutator segments we will have a brush resting on the commutator segment, and these commutator segment they form as a terminal of the DC generator. So DC generator, when it generates, we get the power from or the electrical energy from these two brushes. One will be positive and one will be negative. And the armature winding that is inside these slots, it will be done with a copper wire. And the field winding, this particular field winding, it is supplied with a DC supply, and that DC supply either it can be given from the external source, that will become a separately excited DC generator, or this is the armature winding, right? And this armature winding is connected to the commutator segment, and on top of the commutator segment we have the brush. When electricity generates, we get the DC supply from these two brushes. The same two brushes, that is the armature winding, that can be used to supply this field winding. And if it is in series with this armature winding, we call it as a support. First thing is, if the field winding is supplied from this voltage, then it is called as a self-excited generator. And if this particular field winding is in series with the armature winding, then it is a a series generator. If this field winding is in parallel with this armature winding, then it is a shunt generator. If it is in a combination, so part of the field is in series and part of the field is in parallel, then it is called as a compound generator, and it can be a long shunt compound generator or a short shunt compound generator. So the main parts are what? The main parts are the outer frame, also called as a yoke, and which basically gives a mechanical support, and it will have a eye bolt where you can move, you can lift this. Using this, you can lift the electrical machine if for the purpose of transportation. And on the outer frame, we will be having the a pole system, main pole system. This poles are bolted to the outer frame, and on the pole core we will have the winding. That winding head is called as a field winding, and a pole system will have the pole core and the pole shoes. And this is also made in laminations with the silicon steel material. This complete core structure would be core, and the shoe would be laminated, and they will be stacked together by some kind of a insulation. And silicon steel is used to both in case of a armature core as well as the pole core. Silicon steel is used to reduce the hysteresis loss, and the laminations are used to reduce the eddy current loss. And this pole system forms the stationary part of the DC generator, and these are responsible producing the magnetic field. And inside we have the rotor, that is armature, and armature on the outer periphery there are slots. Inside the slots there is a armature winding, and that armature winding is connected to the commutator segment. It ends the ends are connected to the commutator segment, and on top of the commutator segment we have the brush. Whenever how this operates is, when we give the magnetic field and using a mechanical energy we rotate the armature, the magnetic field produced by the these main pole system is cut by the armature conductors. So according to the Faraday's first law, it will generate the EMF, and commutator will convert negative cycle into positive cycle. That is how at the two brushes we get the DC supply. One brush would be positive and one would be negative. It will be based on the direction of the motion. That is how we will come to know about the polarity, which is positive and which is negative. Okay, so the main parts, I will just show the law. Okay, the main parts are outer frame, yoke, field system or main pole, armature core, and armature core is having the armature winding. Then we have commutator and brush. Okay, commutator, yesterday we saw commutator is done with a hard copper, and it is insulated. The commutator segments are insulated by the mica, and brush is done with a carbon. Okay, and this will be resting on the commutator segment using a spring arrangement, so that it will make a firm contact with the commutator segment. So the same explanation is here. Okay, outer frame, the yoke is made up of cast iron or cast steel, gives a mechanical support, and main pole include pole core, pole shoe and main field winding. Pole is made up of lamination bunched together to construct the pole, and pole winding is wound on this, is called a field winding. Then we have the commutator. Commutator function is to convert AC into DC. It is a cylindrical shape and made up of hard copper. The commutator segments are insulated from each other using mica. Brush is usually made up with the carbon. The number of brush is equal to the number of poles. Eye bolt, it is used to shift the motor from one place to other place. Made with the iron material. So it will be part of the frame. So this is the construction of DC generator. This is how the DC generator is constructed. So on top of the armature, we looked into the armature. On the armature outer slots, we have the armature winding. Basically, there are based on how the winding is done, there are two types of armature winding. One is called as a lap winding, and second one is called as a wave winding. So based on these two types of a winding, there would be number of parallel paths that will be created in the armature winding. The number of parallel paths will depend on whether it is a lap winding or whether it is a wave winding. If in case of a lap winding, number of parallel paths, okay, how you can understand what is the number of parallel paths is, let us say armature winding is having 100 conductors. Either I can connect those 100 conductors in a series. If I connect those 100 conductors in series, how many path I will have for the flow of electric current? There is only one path. It will pass through. Suppose if 10 amperes flows through the one conductor, same 10 amperes will flow through all the conductors. Suppose instead of having as a just one path, I will divide the same 100 conductors into two paths. In one path, 50 conductors, another path 50 conductors, means 50 conductors I will join them in series, and this both the series combination will be connected in parallel, right? When we do this type of a connection, now we have two paths, one path having 50 conductors, another path is having 50 conductors. So how many parallel paths are there? Number of parallel paths is equal to 2. Similarly, if I want to have four parallel paths, same 100 conductors, I will make 25 conductors in series, okay, and such 25 conductors in series, I will connect four of them in parallel. So altogether it makes 100 conductors. In that case, number of parallel paths are 4. Now, if we use the lap winding, the number of parallel paths that would be created, that would be is equal to P. So number of parallel paths is represented by capital letter A. A is equal to P, means number of parallel paths is equal to P is what? Number of poles. If we have the lap winding, number of parallel paths would be equal to number of poles. If we have the wave winding, whenever we have the wave winding, we are going to see how the wave winding is and how the lap winding is. Whenever we use the wave winding, the number of parallel paths are fixed and it is equal to 2. If wave winding, A is equal to 2. Lap winding, A is equal to P. Very important, you have to remember, it will help in solving the problems. How to remember this number of paths? A simple method is lap, L-A-P, P. So you can see the last letter is P. Number of parallel letters, A is equal to P. And another one is A is equal to 2. So if finishing end of one coil is connected via commutator segment to the starting end of the adjacent coil under the same pole is called as a lap winding. Okay, I will show you that. Okay, so you can hear, you can see here, this is one coil, right? The finishing end of one coil is connected to this is one coil. Let me show you. This is one coil. This is another coil, second coil, right? And they are connected to the commutator segments 1, 2, 3. Now, if the finishing end of the coil is connected to the beginning end of the next coil under the same pole, then it is called as a lap winding. So, what is a lap winding? You can see here. If the finishing end of one coil, that is finishing end of one coil, is connected to the starting end of the next coil under the same pole via the commutator segment, then we call it as a lap winding, right? See here. So this is the finishing end of first coil and this is the beginning end of the second coil. They are connected together and through the segment, commutator segment, then it is called as a lap winding. Whenever we use the lap winding, number of parallel paths in the armature A would be equal to P. That is, always we get A is equal to P. If number of poles in the DC generator is 4, number of parallel paths is equal to 4 if it is a lap winding. Now, in the next, in case of a wave winding, so here it is a commutator segment, you are not able to see that. There is a commutator set of commutator segments here. If one side of the coil, so this is the first coil, okay, and this is the second coil. So you can see this is the first coil and this is the second coil. If one side of a coil under one pole is connected to the other side of a coil in the wave fashion, so you can see here one coil is connected to the next coil in a wave fashion, is called as a wave winding. Okay, so if we have connection like this, then it is called as a wave winding. If we have the wave winding, number of parallel paths would be is equal to 2. So if we use the lap winding in the armature, we will get number of parallel paths A is equal to P, and if we use wave winding, number of parallel paths would be equal to